Good morning, everybody. Yesterday, I showed you this example GUI program. We said that we are going to do this. This is an example of a combo box. In the combo boxes, what you do is there is a button here next to a label. When you press that button, you get a new list. And you make a selection from that list. And depending on your event handler, you perform some kind of an action. In this case, in this example, when I select this bug one, the bug one icon will be loaded and it will be shown here. But if I select this one, bug two will be selected. And again, it goes like that, okay? How many items there are, it depends on how many you gave. So let's see the code. Again, our class that holds the main method is the same. We make a new combo box frame object and we make it visible. Okay. And as always, we extend this combo box frame from the JFrame class. Okay. So, JFrame class, it says that I have two things in me. One of them is a combo box, the other one is a label, JLabel. We are going to use JLabel to show our icons. Remember those bug icons? Those will be the labels. And these are the strings that I am going to show inside my combo box, J combo box. And these are the icons that I am going to show with the J label. Okay, so let's look at the constructor. Constructor says that, okay, I'm calling my super class constructor. Layout is the same. Today I will explain the alternatives for the other layout methods. And I have a new combo box. Okay. J combo box. And I put names, which is the string of GIF file names. I gave it as a parameter to the constructor of the combo box. And then I said that the maximum row count is three. So when I pull down that combo box, at most I am going to see three of them. For the rest, I have to scroll down. And then I guess that's it. Other than, yeah, at the end, let's ignore this part. Let's ignore this part for 30 seconds. And then I add my combo box and then I make a new label and I add the label. So I have two adds. One is for adding the J label. The other one is for adding the combo box. Okay. And this ends my class. So you may ask, where is my event handler? Event handler is here. So it is, remember what we used to do? We used to have a private inner class before. Let me go back and let me show you. Let me go back. Okay. So I have an inner here. I have an private inner class that implements the item listener interface, radio button handler. And inside this radio button handler, I have this item state changed method. I have to implement it. It has some constructor and that kind of stuff. So this was our usual method. And we make radio button handler objects and we add them as item listeners or the event handlers. That's what we used to do. This one is doing something different. I mean, this is a feature of Java. We call this an anonymous inner class. Okay. So you are saying that item listener is an interface. Okay, item listener is an interface. And to make objects of an interface, you need to implement an interface with a class and make the objects of interface. But here we say that if I make such a class, if I make such a class that implements the item listener, I am going to make only one object of it. And I'm not going to use it in any other place. So Java says that in those kind of situations, without making a new class or without giving any names to the classes, you can make anonymous inner classes by doing this. New item listener. Okay. New item listener. And then you implement the method that the item listener interface has to implement inside these brackets. So these are called anonymous inner classes. If you use an anonymous inner class, your class doesn't have a name. Okay, your class doesn't have a name. And you make a single object of that class, and that's it. And you are going to use it wherever it is needed. So I need it in one place as an item listener. I make an object without giving it a name, and I use that object. So we didn't have such a thing in C++. At least as far as I know, maybe they have added it with the new versions, I don't know. And Java makes it possible. And for these kind of cases where you don't need more than one object of the same class, which is an implementation of an interface, I could do this. Okay, so let's look at what it does. Item state change, it takes an item event. We did not see examples of an item state changed. Did we? Maybe we did method, okay, or the listener. Okay, it says that, okay, this is my event, get the event, get state change, run the get state change method. It's going to return something. If that return thing is the same as item event.selected, then in that case, I am going to get the which item is selected, okay? Which item is selected? This item. Then I am going to set that selected thing to, with the icons. Get that thing from the icons array and set it to the label.set icon. Remember, label is my J label component. Okay, so every time I make a selection from that combo box, this one will be called. This method will be called. This is my event handler. And in the event handler, I ask, is the state changed? If it is yes, then I am going to get the selected index and choose the corresponding icon from my array, which is this one, and set it to the labels icon. Okay, so that's it. That's the whole program, and this is what you are seeing when the program runs. Okay, so that's the combo box, and if we like to look at a similar example, which is list. So our example will be like that, okay? When I run my program, a list will appear like that. If I choose blue here, the background of the window will be blue. If I choose red, the background will be red, etc. So what is the difference between a combo box and the list? This is a list example. The combo box was the previous one. What is the difference between the list and the combo box? I am not hearing anybody talking.
sir,
Sir,
could
could
you
you ask
ask
one
one
more
more
time,
time,
please?
please?
Is my sound okay? I am asking the difference between a list and a combo box.
We can choose one thing in combo box, am I right?
Well, I mean, in my example, the list is the same. You can choose only one thing. So this is the list. This is the combo box. What is the difference? You are using this all the time, everywhere. Okay, Şevval, I chose you. Şevval Ateş, you tell me what the difference between list and combo box. Şevval, are you there? What are you guys doing? Just logging in the class and go back to sleep? So Şevval is not here.
I'm here, but I don't know the answer.
You are not supposed to know the answer. You are trying to guess. I showed you the stuff. This is a list example, and this is the combo box example. You don't see the difference?
Is it about combination?
Combination of what?
Is it about item select?
Combo box has a special button here. If you don't press this button, you don't see the list. Okay? And if you don't pull this down, there is something always visible. So if I have something like this, where is my Chrome? I think Firefox has a better.
Is there any editable difference between them?
Yeah. So this is kind of combo box. There is always something visible in there. Okay. There is always when I do this. Okay. There is always something visible. But if needed, when you say something like that, you get a list here. So this is like a combo box. With the list is always visible. With the combo box, there is something visible as selected. But if you don't go to that combo box, you don't see the list. That's the difference. Okay, that's the difference. So these are two different related but two different components. Okay, let's see this example. Let's see how we are going to change the background color. And it looks like I am going to have only one component for this JFrame class, list frame. I have this JList, okay, list to display colors. Okay, we are gonna see how we are going to use it. I have a string array with all the colors, and I have a color array with the standard constants for the colors. Okay, color.black, color.blue. Where is this color? Color is this. What is color? What do you think this Java AWT color? What kind of definition do you think it has?
RGB color.
I am talking about line number four. What am I importing with this java.awt.color? What am I importing? What kind of definition does the color have? That's what I'm asking. Is the constant what? Is the class? Is color a class? We have seen examples of this. I didn't show you the color definition, but I showed the similar stuff. If I am using color like that, like line 19, okay, I'm asking Yeshim Yalçın. Yeshim, could you tell me what kind of definition color has? Yeshim? Yeshim, are you there? Yeshim, I am asking you. What kind of definition does the color have? Okay, let's kick her out. Once I find her. So Yeshim is not here, right? So she went back to sleep. I can't find her name now. I will find it. Anybody else?
Static fine values for every color.
So what is color then? Each color is like a static final value, but what is color?
Image.
What is color again?
Image.
Image? What is image? We never know anything like image in Java.
Equal? Not equal, actually.
Okay. Color is a class that contains these kind of static final definitions. Okay. Inside color, I have this black, blue, cyan, gray, and etc. Okay, these are all the definitions inside this color. Or you could have said it is just an interface. Like, remember swing constants interface? We could have had something like that. Okay, so all the stuff inside this color are final static definitions. Okay, so I have a color array, and I choose that color array. Okay, so in our list frame, okay, I am calling my constructor of the superclass, and I put my color names, which is a string of the colors. Okay, color array inside my JList, and I set it to visible, and visible row count is 5 now. It's not a combo box, but a list. And the selection mode is single selection. I could have multiple selections or single selections with the lists. And I add a new scroll pane. So scroll pane is a pane, a kind of a canvas that can hold other components, and it is used for scrolling. So color JList in this case, JList is not scrollable by itself, but if I like to make it scrollable, then I make it inside a J scroll pane. Okay, so I will never add this color J list to my frame, but I am adding it to this scroll pane. And then, like I did before, add list selection listener. I am making an anonymous inner class, and this list selection, we never did it before. Okay, so this one calls this value change method. I have to implement it. So with the value change, what I do is, okay, I ask the color J list which item of your list is selected. I get the selected index, I get the corresponding color, and I get the background of the content pane. Okay, so this is one example of list. But this list has a scroller. Okay, by default, our lists don't have any scrollers. If I didn't have the scroller added, I wouldn't have this scroller bar in here. Okay, any questions? No questions, then I will continue. If I like to do such a thing, let me show you the final stuff, okay? So tell me what these are. What is this? How many components do you see on this window?
Three
components. One button in the middle. There is a list on the left. And there is another, maybe a text area or an unscrollable list. I don't know what it is on the right. Okay. So the task of this window is simple. It is very simple. Whatever you have selected, so it's going to be a multiple selection list. Whatever I have selected, okay, when I hit this copy button, they will be copied to this area on the right. So I need to write a event handler for this button. Other than that, I don't need anything else in terms of the event handlers. So let's look at this implementation very quick. Okay, so it looks like I have two lists. One is the color list, the other one is the copy list. So on the left and right, there are two lists, but one of them is going to have the scroller, the other one doesn't have the scroller. And I have a copy button. This is the constructor, flow layout. Okay. I make a new list with the color names. Set visible count is 5. Selection mode is now multiple interval selection. So I can select more than one item. And I add this to a scroll pane. That's fine. And I added a new button. Okay. Instead of writing a new action listener class, I directly implement this action listener. When the action performed method is called, what I do is I get the color list get selected values, and set list data is copied to the copy J list. So these are the things that you're going to learn by reading the documentation. There is no way that you can remember all that stuff. And people ask me in the final exam, are you going to ask questions about GUI programming? Well, I may ask you some questions about the GUI programming, but it wouldn't be something like write a GUI program that does this and this and this. No, I mean, nobody's expected to remember all these detailed stuff. Okay, so our main purpose here is We are practicing our Java knowledge. Also, we are practicing our object-oriented programming knowledge. Okay? So as you see, one benefit of object-oriented programming is the number of parameters of your methods, okay, are going to be much smaller than the other languages like the C. For C functions, you need to pass everything that they need, okay? And they need to use all global functions everywhere. With object-oriented programming, you don't pass many parameters, okay? All the most of the stuff that they need is available either as a instance variable or some inherited variables, okay? Also for the methods to be called, most of them are inherited. So the writing object-oriented code is much simpler. You don't have to pass along lots of parameters. Your code will not look very crowded. Okay, so and did we add the second? How many ads do we have here? I have scroll pane here. J button, I added. Did I add the J button? Where is J button? Oh, okay. This one is action listener. Okay. I added the J button. And this is the second one. This is the one copied list. Okay, copy J list. Visible row count is 5. Cell width is okay, so I am setting the width of the window or the list and the height. And single selection, and there is a scroll pane. It looks like I don't see the scroll pane in here because I don't have enough number of elements that needs a scroll pane. Okay, so both of them has the scroller available. Okay, so that's one example with the multiple selection list. Okay, so let's look at the so far we only dealt with some events regarding the component selection, item selection, mouse, the button presses, button pushes, etc. Let's look at some mouse events. Let me show you the example that I am going to study in a few minutes. Okay, this is your window. There is a message line at the beginning. Mouse outside J panel. When I move mouse in the panel or my window, okay, the background color changes and I print this message. Mouse moved at 8 and 13. What is 8? 8 is this is 8 coordinate and this is 13. Okay, this is the coordinate system of Java, right? So when I move my mouse, I will always get this message at the end. So when I move the mouse, it will create an event. That event will be handled by my event handler, and my event handler will get the mouse position and it will put this message at the bottom of this window. And then when I click at any part of the window, I will print this message. So that means that there is another event handler for mouse clicks. So this position is here, 38 and 10. So this is 38 and this is 10. And then what? And press. Press is different than click. Okay. With the click, you press and you release, right? Okay. With the press, you only press and you wait. Okay. So you press it, you drag it, and you release it. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 different events, at least 5 different events. I need to write 5 different events. Event handlers. Let's see how I am going to do that. Okay. As always, my class that holds the main method is same. Mouse tracker frame. I am going to write that one. Let's look at that mouse tracker frame implementation. Okay, so I have two components: mouse panel, J panel, and J label. J panel, I did not use it before, but J label, I know that. What is J label? J label is going to be this message bar here. This is my going to be J label, and this blue part is going to be my panel, J panel. J panel will be empty, so I'm going to change its color. Other than that, it's going to be empty. Okay, mouse tracker frame, demonstrating mouse events. J panel, set background, color white. Okay, and I add my panel, and I say that put this panel in the center. And I have a label, mouse outside J panel, the initial value, and I add this status bar to the south of the window. There is something missing in this constructor that we used to do before. Did you notice what is missing? We always did something at the beginning after we called the super classes constructor. We did something here before adding any components to my frame. We did not do that now. What did we do?
Setting LDO layout.
Süleyman, say it louder.
Setting a layout.
Yes, layout. We didn't set the layout. What is layout? Layout layout tells the system that you should place my components in such and such way. And I am not going to use the flow layout. Instead, I am telling the system that, okay, I am going to determine the layout myself. This panel is going to be at the center, and this status bar will be at the south. So I don't need the layout now, because I am telling the system what to do now. Okay, so I added these two things, and I have a handler now, mouse handler. Okay, and I will add that handler as a mouse listener and the mouse motion listener. There are two types of mouse listeners. One of them is a mouse listener, the other one is a mouse motion listener. And let me show you the difference between them. Mouse listener is this. Okay. Mouse listener interface defines 1, 2, 3, 4 methods. Okay. The first method is called when mouse is pressed. The second is called when mouse is clicked, released, and entered. So these are the mouse listener events. If you like to handle one of them, then you need to implement this interface and provide implementation to all of the methods in there. And this one, mouse exited. Okay, this one is part of the mouse listener. So there are five of them. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 methods for the mouse listener and 2 methods for the mouse motion listener. Okay, if the mouse is dragged or moved, then these 2 methods are called. Then you need to implement the mouse motion listener. So let's go to constructor again. So question, how come I can use the same handler as both mouse listener and mouse motion listener? I showed you there are two interfaces, right? One is for mouse listener, the other one is mouse motion listener. But I am using the same handler, mouse handler, for both of them. How could this happen?
Because we have one mouse.
Yeah, but as I said before, as I showed you before, I need two different interfaces. One for the mouse listener, one for the mouse motion listener. And I am using the same object to listen to both types of listeners.
Are they used clone of mouse handler?
Well, I am not, as you see, there are no cloning here. There is one new operator. It makes a new mouse handler object. And I provide the reference of that object to the mouse listener and the mouse motion listener, both of them. How could this happen?
All the methods, mouse listener and mouse motion listener. So it can work with both.
Yeah. Mouse handler implements both mouse listener and mouse motion listener. Okay. That's exactly right. So remember what Java said? Java said that a class can implement more than one interface. There is no multiple inheritance, but when it comes to interface implementation, a class can implement as many interfaces as it likes. Okay, so maybe I was not that clear or detailed about the main problems of multiple inheritance. In C++, this is possible. Let's say I have a person class. For the person class, usually what you would have a private name string and private social security number, again a string. Let's say I have my employee class. For the employee class, usually I will have, let's say, salary double. Okay, and then let's say another one, a student class. I have what? I have GPA, again a double. This is nice so far. Both Java and C++ can support such a thing. But if I do this multiple inheritance for the class student employee, I like to have this class because I have objects, okay, that are both employees, they have salaries, also they have their GPAs. This would be nice, right? This would be nice. But this creates problems for the compilers. Why? Because I will inherit, okay, from this side, I will inherit this name and social security number once, and then I will inherit the same thing from this side too. So as you see, this student employee will have two copies of name and social security number. And we don't like that. This creates problems for the compilers. C++ uses lots of complicated stuff to solve this. And you say that I am using this virtual classes. There are virtual classes in C++. You will say that I am inheriting this as a virtual and etc. that kind of stuff. And I didn't show that. Java says that, no, I am not going to allow it. I am not going to allow it. You cannot have multiple inheritance. If you are extending a class, you could extend only one class. That's it. You are not allowed to extend more than one class. So Java doesn't run into this problem. Instead, Java says that if you need such a thing, maybe you could implement two interfaces. Okay, there is an employee interface and student interface, and you implement them both. So why do you think that implementing two interfaces doesn't have this problem. Interface implementation avoids this problem. Why do you think it's the problem? Let me try to put some, for example, get SSN str. Okay, some functions in there. Why do you think implementing two interfaces avoids this problem? Java doesn't.
Yes. Data members in interfaces, there are public certificate files, so it won't create a problem for using this inheritance. So there's no diamond problem in implementing two interfaces.
I don't know what diamond problem is, but with the interfaces, if you are implementing an interface, you are providing the implementation yourself. You don't inherit any implementations. You don't inherit any non-static, okay, non-final instance variables. You cannot. That's why there is no conflict of inheriting the same variable more than once or inheriting the same implementation more than once. Okay? So that's not going to be a problem. That's not going to be a problem. For example, if you have, let's say I have a function named get address here and another function get address. So with the multiple inheritance, I have two implementations here, right? I have two implementations for the get address. Which one am I going to call? That's a problem. But if you are implementing two interfaces, employee and student interfaces, there are no implementations, okay? All you are inheriting is the header of the method or the function. That's why I don't have this problem. So this mouse handler implements two interfaces, and mouse listener has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I guess, methods, and motion listener, mouse motion listener has 1 and 2 methods to implement. So I need to implement all 7 of them. 7 methods has to be, 7 methods have to be implemented in this case. Okay. So what are those methods? Let's look at the methods one by one. The first one is mouse clicked. When the mouse clicked, this method will be called automatically. And I am asking the event, okay, because it's a mouse event, right? What is your X position and Y position? And I'm going to change this text of the status bar, which is the label at the bottom, okay, to this string. When the mouse is pressed, then I am going to change the string to this one. Click that, press that, release that. Mouse entered. When mouse enters to my window, I again change the status bar text. Also, I change the panel background color to green. When mouse exits my window, then I set my background to white. Okay? So this GUI library is using Java and object-oriented programming techniques in an effective way. And they designed it very well. By the way, this kind of event programming design is not the invention of Java, okay? And this has been known since 1980s, okay? For the graphical user interface programming in 1980s, end of 1980s, or the middle of 1980s, they have developed these kind of techniques, callbacks, okay? And during those days, they used to program everything with C. And in fact, if you like, you can X11 X11. X window is one of the, okay, earliest graphical user interface systems. X window system, C program example for mouse events. Okay, let me try to show you some C-based graphical user interface programming. X events, so X events are there. Okay, I am trying to find the mouse events. Mouse button press, okay, good. Mouse pointer enter and leave events. So they used to use this kind of structs to keep the mouse events. See, there is event X, event Y, root X, root Y. I don't know what the root, and I think event X, event Y are the current mouse position. Root X, Y maybe the X, Y position of the window, maybe. I'm not sure. So this is the C code. This is a very similar, yeah, this is a very similar example. If you are writing this in C. So as an example for handling events, we show a program that creates a window of enters and loop. Okay, so this one has the main loop. Remember that dispatch and catch, dispatch and event loop. It checks all the events. And this one will handle all the mouse events, I guess. So this is my main function. I have to initialize many things. Okay, you may have more than one screen, my window, some temporary values. I need to connect to my server. I need to get my screen, create the window. Okay, here. See how many parameters I need to pass to create a window. Okay. Most of them I don't understand, I don't care, okay, but with this case I have to provide all of them. Without object-oriented programming you need to do all of this stuff. Okay, map window, my connection to my window, and okay, so this is my main loop. Remember when I said you check for the events and you handle it. You have to write that loop explicitly yourself in C. This while loop says that, okay, E response type, okay, X, C, B wait for event. You are waiting for an event. When this event happens in a parallel thread, you get that event and you process that event. If this event is something handleable, okay, and then I am going to look at that event. Okay, if it's an exposed thing, okay, then expose, I guess. Okay, so this is different. I need to draw my window because my window is exposed. Okay, so I am calling the expose event. Wait, what's going on? Okay, this is an EV. I am not going to call anything, so I am just printing a message here. It is just a message to show that I am exposed, I am drawing myself. For the button presses, I get the event. And I make a switch on the event detail, and I get those and I print them on the screen. I guess button up, button down. There is a single button in this case. And release here, motion here, notify, okay. Leave here, key presses here, release again. And default, I don't know. And then I free my event. That's interesting. And then this is the end of the loop. So the loop exits, the loop exits when this one returns zero. Okay, so we used to do this kind of stuff. Okay, I didn't register any event handlers. Did I register any event handlers? No, I did not, because I am writing my loop myself. That's why I did not register anything. Okay. So this one is much more understandable, my version, this version, because it tells you what you need to do to handle those events. And if you don't provide any of these methods, then your program will not compile because your class will stay abstract. Okay. And you cannot, by mistake, register a different mouse handler, because if it is not the correct type, it cannot be registered. It cannot be added as a mouse listener. So object-oriented programming makes my life a lot easier. Okay, let me take 10 minutes of break. After the break, we will continue. Okay, everybody. So we did this mouse example, and it looks like it is all standard. What you are doing is you are adding a component. I repeated this before. You say that this is my frame. Okay, I am going to add these components, maybe a list, maybe a pane, a button, a string, a label. And these are my event handlers, okay? Event handler one and event handler two, etc. That's the standard GUI programming stuff. Putting in your components, making new components out of the old ones, and providing the event handlers, okay? And that's the standard graphical user interface programming. Again, this is different than your main program. For example, that's what you're going to do with your optional homework, which is the graphical user interface for your hex program. Okay, so your hex program is different, your graphical user interface is different, and it is best for you to keep your interface from the remaining of the program, because you may want to use two versions of your program. One is with the graphical user interface, one is with the regular terminal interface, okay? And this is much better in terms of portability. If you like to port your program to run with the Windows operating system graphical user interface, it's going to be different. And if you like to use it with different graphical user interface, it's going to be different. Well, Java kind of makes it more standard, because if you are writing your graphical user interface using Java, since Java has the virtual machine, you could use your program in both Windows and Linux and other operating systems. That's going to be fine. But it is, again, it is best to keep your graphical interface programming from the separate from the other parts of your program, from the engine of your program. Okay. Good. Let's move on. Let's see. We never did any keyboard related event handling. Okay. So let's look at some event handling stuff. Before we move on, actually, let's look at these two interfaces. Okay, let's say I like to use this mouse listener, but I am not interested in mouse exit events, mouse entered events, mouse released or mouse clicked. All I am interested in is mouse pressed. Okay, I like to know when the mouse is pressed, and I don't want to know the other events. What am I gonna do? If it is the case, I will have to implement this mouse clicked. But if I don't implement this one or that one or that one, my mouse handler class will be an abstract class, because I will have to implement them, otherwise my implementation would be missing and my class would be abstract. So in that case, what am I going to do? I will implement them, I will not do anything, okay? They all will be empty. So they said that maybe Java library, Java GUI library, should implement all of these interfaces, okay? Okay, let's say I have window listener. Window adapter is a class. Okay, it's a class that implements this window listener. So what does it do? How does it implement it? It implements them by doing nothing. So all the methods are empty. They are just implemented, but they are empty. So this mouse listener is implemented by mouse adapter. And inside that mouse adapter class, all the methods are empty. Okay. Methods are like this, curly bracket and curly bracket. That's it. Since those are void methods, I am not returning anything. So all of these classes are event handler classes, adapter classes we call them, and they don't do anything. So why did they do that? They did this because if I like to just implement one of the methods, all I do is I extend this mouse adapter class. I extend it, not implement it, because these are classes. And I override whatever I like to change. Okay, that's what I'm going to do. These are the adapter classes. So let me show you what we are going to do now. Okay, this is very simple class again. This is much simpler than what I showed you before. Click mouse. Okay, mouse click two times. Okay, mouse clicked one time, when mouse clicked five times, etc. So very simple. Let's look at the implementation. This part is again the same. Okay, so there is a string details, there is a label, that's it. And this one has super and status bar, there is a label, and I add that status bar. And I add a mouse listener. Okay, new mouse click handler. Okay, that's it. So where did I add this mouse listener? I add this to JFrame. So it is handling the JFrame mouse handling stuff. And as you see, this one extends the mouse adapter. Not implements, but extends. Okay, so since I am extending it, I don't have to implement mouse release, mouse pressed, mouse mode, etc. Okay, all I need to do is whatever method I need to override, I am just overriding it. I override mouse clicked. I would get X and Y positions. And I would get the click count. And if meta is the right mouse button, I get it. If the center mouse is down, I would get the alternate down. Okay. And that's it. And I change my status bar. So this example is not really about mouse event handling. This example is about adapter classes. So adapter classes are not part of Java, of course. That's a good idea invented by this GUI designers, so that you don't have to implement all the other methods of event listener interfaces if you don't need to, because that would look funny and unnecessary.
Can I say?
Sure.
In the previous example, there was not entered event listener. Can we change the borders of this event listener? For example, instead of mouse entering a whole lot of panel, we just take only good part of the panel. Can we see that?
How could you do? I mean, that event listener is for the whole JFrame. Okay, so if you like to do the entering stuff. Yes.
Oh,
what? If you like to do the smaller part of the window, then you need to add a new component, okay, and add these mouse motion listener or mouse listener event handlers for that component only. If this is my JFrame, I add a new component this part. And if you like to do the mouse entered and mouse left events for this part of the window only, so you need to add your event handler for this one. As you see, I added this mouse listener to this JFrame. Okay. In the previous example, I have added, where is it? Yeah, okay. So I have added this handler in my mouse panel. Okay, in my mouse panel. It is not for the whole frame, but mouse panel. What was the mouse panel? I think my window was like that. And there is this status bar. And this green part is my panel. So in a way that I did what you were mentioning, okay? I mean, the entered left events are for the screen part only, not for the whole J-frame. Okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Good, any other questions? Okay, so another example, let's look at this one. Let's look at this example. When you run this program, by dragging the mouse, I can draw anything that I like. Okay, I can draw anything that I like. Like, okay, I come here, I press my mouse, I write Java like that. Okay, somebody has drawn this. Drag the mouse to draw, it says. So how are we going to do that? So first, I should get the mouse press stuff. Yeah, mouse pressed or mouse dragged. Okay, I would get to drag them out and I would draw something in that position. But I should not forget what I had drawn before, because if needed, I will redraw it. If needed, I will redraw it. Okay, let's do this. This is our main method of the painter. I have a J-frame application. Now, I did not extend. See, I did not extend J-frame, but I make a new J-frame. I have a paint panel. This is my new class. I have a paint panel. And we are going to see it in a few minutes. Okay. I am adding this paint panel to my application, to my frame. And I add a J label as south. Okay. To the bottom of the window. This is in the center. And the rest is the same. So this time I did not extend the J frame. I didn't do that. Instead, I added a new panel to my J frame. Let's see how that panel is implemented. My panel is here, paint panel. There is a private integer point count is zero. And I have a point array. Point is a two-dimensional, point is a class that represents two-dimensional points on a surface, on a plane, okay? X and Y positions. And at most, I can have 10,000 points. Currently, I have zero. Paint panel constructor says that I have a mouse motion listener. See, I am using an adapter, not the interface. And let's see how it does. Mouse dragged. I am only interested in mouse dragging operation. I get the event. If the length of the points is greater than my number of points, I get the event point, okay? And I increment the event point by one, and I store that event point to my points array. And there is a method called repaint. This paints the whole screen. So this is the repaint. Oh, okay, I don't see it. Where is repaint? Where is repaint? I don't see any repaint implementations anywhere. Maybe use the red. Maybe use the red pen repaint. Where does repaint come from? Okay, let's keep this in mind and let's look at this paint component. Paint component is called, again, remember paint component we had written like two lectures ago? Paint component is called automatically when my window needs to be painted. So tell me when my windows needs to be painted. When do you think this paint component is called I'm not going to call it. I didn't call it. I call repaint, but I didn't call the paint component.
When we draw something to panel?
But how does the system know that you drew something on the panel?
With click the button.
But whenever I click on the window, that doesn't mean that that window has to be redrawn. For example, okay, for example, this is my Chrome window. I am clicking on it. Okay, I am dragging it. I don't have to redraw anything. The window stays the same. I mean, clicking on it or dragging on it doesn't mean that it has to be repainted. What else? Under what conditions do you think the system paints a window?
If you press on special button.
What kind of special button? Tell me a special button.
To paint.
For example, this. If I click on this button, my window changed and it is repainted. If I scroll it, it is repainting it, right? I am repainting everything because I am scrolling it. I minimize it and I restore it. I am repainting it, okay? These are the stuff for repainting. When the repainting happens, okay, this paint component with the necessary parameters will be called. And this one says that, okay, I am going to run this loop from zero to point count, whatever it is. I stored all the points in my array, and I will do this fill oval. Fill oval is doing this. Oval means it's like an ellipse. Ellipse, okay. But in this case, it is size, the radius is 4, and this one is 4. So it's basically a circle. So fill oval means that fill a circle for me of size 4x4. At this point, so it will follow all the mouse clicks and it will put ovals like that on my mouse clicks. Okay, that's why this looks like kind of funny. Okay, so that's what I did with this loop. But again, repaint is not paint component. So repaint means that I am calling the repaint method of this JPanel, saying to the system that, okay, I did something and I think you need to repaint my window. And when the repaint is called, it will do automatically other stuff, and among them is calling the paint component with the graphics object. Okay, so this is how you combine mouse event handling with the painting of your windows. Again, lots of other details, but you got the idea. Good. Any questions about this? Any questions? Okay, if there are no questions, then I will continue. Let's look at some keyboard stuff. Okay, so far we looked at the mouse events. Let's look at the keyboard events. Key listener interface. With the key listener interface, let me show you the output of what I'm gonna do. This is my window. On that window, if you press a key on your keyboard, for example, in this case, key A is pressed. And when the key A, thank you, sir. Okay, so when a key is pressed, this one is A. This is not an action key. Action key is one of those F1, F2 kind of stuff. Okay, modifier is not pressed. Let's see one action key and the modifier. Okay, if you press the shift key, now I got it, see? Up to now, our scanf functions or our cin objects, stream insertion, extraction objects, they didn't know if my shift is pressed or alt button is pressed or window button is pressed. I didn't know that because my input output routines are not that low level. But now I can know shift is pressed or not, or ALT, the alternate button, is pressed or not, or F1, F2, F3 is pressed or not. Okay, so this one, see, F1 is pressed. Okay, F1 is an action key, and with no modifiers it is pressed. Okay, if you like, you could do the Control Shift and F1, and I can do that. Okay, let's look at the implementation again. I am making a new JFrame, and with the new JFrame, I will have a text area to show my strings. My strings will be three lines, 1, 2, 3. Okay. Every time I need to show something, I am going to change these lines. But this is interesting. Read line 9 and explain it to me. Is this a good idea? I think it's a good idea. So what is the advantage of doing this? While you are looking at it, I am going to open this yellow envelope. This means trouble. Okay, it is not much, yeah. So, line 9. Did you understand line 9? Key listener is an event listener. I am extending JFrame. Kamil, you tell me, okay? I gave up for the rest of the class. I have only you. Don't let me down.
Okay. The extending JFrame is actually standard.
That's what we did before, but the new part is the implementation part. The implements key listener.
Because we want to know which key is pressed. We want to know that information. So the key listener is the interface that we should implement.
Yeah, but previously we used to write different classes for key listeners, right? Either anonymous class or a separate inner class. Now I am doing this. Maybe you should combine line 9 with line 27.
27?
Yeah. So add key listener, it expects an object of type key listener, right?
Yes.
And this is a key listener, right? Because I am implementing key listener. But to be a key listener, what do I need to know? What do I need to implement? I need to implement key pressed, key released, and key typed, right? So three things. I am implementing three things inside this class, okay? Key demo frame, and I become a key listener. And I am now my key listener object. I am both a JFrame, also I am a key listener. So I don't have to write a new class now, right? So I think this is smart. This is good. So if you are writing this, if you are writing listeners, then you do it this way. And the nice thing is that you can put as many listeners as you like with the separated with the commas.
Will it be a problem in the program?
Would it be a problem in the program? What do you mean?
Because we use JFrame and KListener in the same time. Can it be a problem for us? I can't imagine now, but I just wonder it.
Well, I mean, if you overdo it, it might make your class, JFrame class, more complicated than it needs to be. Yeah. But, I mean, we used to make a separate inner class anyway. So I used to implement these methods inside my inner class anyway. So it was part of my class, but it was a part of the inner class's methods. Now they are my methods. So if your class is as simple as this, I don't see any problems in terms of making it more complicated. Okay.
Okay.
So what I am doing here is, okay, I text area, okay, is going to be, we didn't see anything like that before. So it's a text area that shows text. So I'm going to show text of 3 lines. Let me go to this key typed. Okay, set lines to entry. Set lines to entry changes the text of the text area with these 3 lines, line 1, line 2, and line 3. Line 1 is what? What is line 1? I think line 1 is fixed. Line 1 is this. It is key pressed, and I get the get even text from the event. And get key code. Key code is the code of the key. And after that, I set line 2 and 3. Line 2 and 3 is doing this. For line 2, I get whether it's an action key or not. Like the F1 is an action key, right? A is not an action key. And for line 3, it is modifier key, like the shift or control or ALT. So I set this line 1, line 2, and line 3 to the text area. Okay, so this is set lines to entry. Every time I make a change, I call key typed, and key typed calls set lines to entry. Key release is doing the same thing. Key press is doing the same thing. I think I have only 3 methods. Okay. So I am responding to 3 things: key presses, key releases, and key type. Key type is like button click, mouse click. Key presses, mouse press. Key releases, mouse release. Something like that, okay? So we never did anything like that before because we did not control the keys. All we had is we asked the operating system to give us a string. I got the string. We didn't talk about the keys. Now we are talking about the keys. I can know which key is pressed, which key is released. If you are doing game programming, of course you need to be able to do that kind of stuff. Okay, so that's the key handling stuff. Good. Okay, are there any questions? Graphical user interfaces has their own worlds, and I don't mean to cover everything about the graphical user interfaces. And in fact, usually you don't write these kind of programs yourself. There are graphical user interface editors. Okay, with the graphical user interface editors, this is the software, right? And Visual Studio comes with it. There are many other Eclipse add-ins for designing your graphical user interfaces. The graphical user interface editors are like this. They say that, okay, these are your components. Let's say this is a button, this is list, panel, etc. This is your window that you are designing. What you do is you move this here and then there, this one there. So you design your graphical user interface using, again, graphical user interface editor. And for each one, you provide callbacks or event handlers. Okay. So usually graphical user interfaces, okay, are designed using graphical user interfaces again. I didn't show you how to do that. I am showing you the hard way, the programming way. And I like your homework 7 to be done that way. Don't use any graphical user interface design editors. Okay. So where did I come from? They have their own words. I don't mean to go into the details of all the graphical user interface designing stuff. I am just trying to show you some Java programs, and I'm trying to teach you how we use this kind of stuff in real life. Okay, let's look at this layout managers. So far we looked at flow layout, which is laying out your components from left to right, top to bottom. That's the flow layout. Okay. Flow layout is the simplest layout manager. That's what we have used so far, most of the time. Okay, we did two ways. Either flow layout automatically or we did everything ourselves. Okay. So let's look at the other two popular ways of laying out your components. Flow layout, border layout, and grid layout. Okay. Flow layout example is here. I have three buttons. Okay. Very simple example again. But this time, when I click on left, my flow layout will be left justified. When I click on right, it will be right justified. When I click on center, it will be center justified. So let's look at this example. Okay. I am using the flow layout, set the layout like that. Okay. And I have three buttons, left, center, right. Okay. This is my left layout, left button. And for the left button, I add a new action listener, anonymous inner class. Okay. If somebody presses this left button, I change the alignment of the layout, which is the flow layout, okay, to the left. Okay. So for my center button, I provide another action listener and I change my alignment to center. For the right, I change my alignment to right. So I am playing with the parameters of the flow layout while my program runs. So that's one example. The next example is going to be my border layout. Let me show you the output first again. Okay. I have five buttons. Okay. North button, south button, center, west, and east. When I click any of them, it will be hidden. For example, if I click on the north button, north is hidden. Then if I click on the south button, south will be hidden. And then when I click on the west button, west is hidden, etc. It will go that way. Okay, so let's see the code. I have how many buttons? I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 buttons for 5 strings. And I'm going to use the border layout. Okay, I have a border layout. Between each component, there will be 5 pixel horizontal and 5 pixel vertical gap. And I am setting my layout like border layout. And these are my buttons. And for each name, I create a button and I add my action listener. See, I implement this action listener, line 9. And for each one, I add this. Okay. And I am adding each button one by one. First, the north button, south button, east, west, and center button. For each one, whenever it is clicked, okay. Okay, this is a nice loop. I loop over all the buttons. If the source of the event is the current button of the loop, then I set it to visible to false. Otherwise, they're all visible true. Okay. So every time I make a click, one of them will not be visible. All the rest will be visible. That's the idea. So this is the border layout. Border layout asks you to specify where it should place the component. And the final one is the grid layout. Grid layout is supposed to lay out your components using something like a grid. So this is a 2x3 grid, two lines and three columns. Okay, and you can change that. And you are going to use something like that for your hex game. Each cell is going to be a button. And how many buttons you are going to have depends on the hex board size. To make to mark a cell, you need to press one of the buttons, and of course that button cannot be pressed anymore. It has to be disabled, and its color has to be changed, and etc. That's what you're gonna do. Okay, so let's see the example here. I have buttons. I have six names for the buttons. I have grid layout 1 and 2. What does that mean, grid layout 1? Okay, it says that 2x3 grid layout and 5 pixel gaps between them. This is 3x2. Okay, one of them has 2 columns, the other one has 3 columns. Okay, and first I am using grid layout 1. And my buttons, I create all of my buttons, action listener this. And I add my buttons, all them. And whenever an action, whenever a button is pressed, it says that if toggle, then I am going to use grid layout 2. If not, then grid layout 1. And every time I change my toggle, toggle is at the beginning, I guess, where is toggle? True, yeah. So it's going to be true, false, true, false. Every time I press a button, push a button, I switch from one example to the other, one layout to other layout. So I can do this dynamically. So when I click this one, I switch to that one. If I click this, I switch to this. Good. So that's an example for the grid layout. If you like to have more than one panel, let me show you a few more examples without going into the details, okay? I have two sections of this frame. This is my panel here, and this is my second panel. I am not adding my buttons to the J frame, but I am adding it to my panel, so I can change it. Text area is something standard. Here is a text area. You can type whatever you like in this area. It is typable, okay? Copying, pasting, all kind of things can happen. And I added this copy button so that whatever I selected can be copied to the right side. So this is a text area demo. And of course, you can use the scrollers for these with these demos. Okay, I guess that's it. That's all I want to talk about GUI programming of Java. More importantly, this is how we use Java libraries And this is how we design Java libraries. Remember the documentation that I showed you, okay? How they design those classes and the methods within the classes. Of course, you cannot do such a thing in overnight. Doesn't matter how experienced Java programmer or programmer you are. It will take some time to design such systems. And they didn't come up with all the ideas like event-based processing, event-based GUI stuff, okay? Those are very old theories and they work very fine. So it takes a few iterations to come up with those kind of large hierarchies, nice written libraries. The important thing is trying more, testing more, trying to get ideas from other people, and trying to behave like a customer. If I am the customer, how would I use this interface? That's the most important thing. Okay, that's it for me. Do you have any questions? Like this, okay. Java has many other. Where is my GUI? Where is my other stuff? So Java has many other libraries, such as the multi-threading library or networking library. Okay. So many tutorials are available on the web for multi-threading, okay, or networking, that kind of stuff. It is up to you to read them, try to write programs and get familiarized with them. That way you are going to be better Java programmer, C++ programmer. Also, you will know about multi-threading or networking. Okay. So that's it from me today. I will assign your bonus. Homework today or tomorrow. But you know what it is, right? It is you are writing a Java GUI interface for your hex game using grid layout and buttons. You are not allowed to use any graphical user interface editors. Everything will be done manually by your hand. Okay.
Will it be specific functions? Can we start right now?
No. Well, you could start right now. Yeah. The homework will be very short. Okay. It's going to be the same functionality play. Okay. And when you press the button, it's going to be played. Maybe reset and resize and that kind of stuff. Other than that, it's going to be the same.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, everybody. That's the end of the lectures. I hope you got something out of this class. But I am very concerned. Nobody's asking questions. I have only 35-40 people listening to the last lecture of the semester. I hope you know what you are doing. Sometimes I am wrong, but I have a very bad feeling. I never had such a feeling before because I used to see your name. Now I am looking at somebody that dressed like a warrior. Yunus Emre, what is that? Are you a warrior? So it is so weird to teach a class like that. So I don't know. I hope you are okay. I hope you are understanding what I am telling you. If not, I don't know. I think I am in trouble. This country is in trouble. Because as a department, if you are not going to produce good engineers, I don't know what this country is going to do. Okay. I'll see you around.
Thank you, sir. Have a nice day.
You too. Thank you. Thank you.